Hey guys, Sean C. Phillips here with my June 11th DVD update. We're talking about the DVDs and Blu-rays I've gotten over the last 2 weeks or so. Like what I say, guys, enjoy these update videos. Definitely give this video a thumbs up. Leave me comments below what you guys saw, the titles I checked out this update, any future titles coming up that you guys would like me to review for future updates, some of the things you guys have picked up recently. Now, the first two I got from Shout Factory's Scream Factory line are the brand new collector's edition releases of Jeepers Creepers and Jeepers Creepers 2, with really cool new artwork on these. Really love the new artwork on these ones. And these ones have a bunch of new features. The first Jeepers Creepers that you haven't seen, it is basically about Justin Long's character and his sister. They're driving back. She was going to like a school thing, like looking at a school. They're driving back home, and basically they're on this road in the middle of nowhere in a kind of like a desert small town kind of area, and this weird beat up old pickup truck is like coming up behind them, driving real fast and kind of like, you know, hitting into the back of their car and honking at them and messing with them and driving erratic and crazy. And they basically start panicking, not knowing what they're going to do, and the person driving this car eventually ends up just driving off and speeding off. And later, you know, after the car ends up getting away and they're kind of panicking about what had happened, the car, they end up seeing the guy in the car, looks like a body wrapped up in a sheet. He's like dropping this body down into this pipe in the middle of the ground, and Justin Long's character's like, we've got to figure out what's going on. This guy could have killed somebody. This person could still be alive. So they get the idea of him crawling down into this vent after that creeper, you know, who dropped the body down there, leaves. He gets the idea of going down to this vent. Of course, doing this, Justin Long goes down there and discovers there's all these bodies like all over the walls. It's a really cool, crazy sequence of these bodies everywhere. And then right after this happens, they're panicking and figuring out how they're going to get to the police. You know, and then, like I said, it's all in this small town, so they're trying to figure out what they're going to do. And there's also these weird things going on with this town. Like, does the town know about what's going on here? And you're kind of wondering that the whole time. But eventually, though, this creeper character, is essentially what it is he locks onto Justin Long's character and his sister and wants to do anything he can to basically, you know, get them and put them as part of their collection. That's essentially what it is. Has on here, though, a new commentary track with the director and Justin Long and Gina Phillips. And then a look back at the making of the film, a brand new featurette on here with the director and the director of photography and the producer. Also on here, a look at the producer, like a featurette on him. And a look at actress Patricia Belcher, and then the original features from the old releases of the deleted scenes and, you know, theatrical trail and things like that. And if you haven't seen Jeepers Creepers 2, that's basically, because in the story of the Jeepers Creepers, the creeper character can basically hunt. He goes away for like, I think it's like 20-some years. I don't know if it says in the back. I can't remember exactly how many years it is, but he goes away for all these certain amount of years to come back and kind of hunt. And part 2 actually takes place the very next day after the events of part 1. So it's basically like right after, on the last day that the creeper character can actually do his hunting, and he ends up seeing this bus of all these school kids that are at a I think it's a basketball game, and it's like the boys in there and then the cheerleader and the teachers and all that kind of stuff on this bus, and the creeper character ends up throwing this like star into the bus's tire, and the bus ends up crashing on the side of the road and kind of gets stranded there, and they're kind of panicking, figuring out how they're going to get out of there. And of course, basically the creeper is basically going and hunting these kids and killing them off one by one. There's some really cool kills in this one. I actually really like this one. And Ray Wise plays the father. In the beginning of the movie, his son ends up getting taken away by the creeper, and he's kind of doing anything he can to try and hunt and find the person responsible. And even the creeper ends up leaving one of his weapons behind. And Ray Wise's character is kind of messing around with it and seeing that it's kind of like got all these weird properties to it. And he kind of wants to see if he can actually kill the creeper with his own weapon. I actually, like I said, this is a pretty cool one. Has on here, though, a commentary track on this one, a brand new Then and Now featuring interviews with the director of photography, editor, and actor on here. Father's Revenge, an interview with Ray Wise. Don't Get Off the Bus, an interview with some of the other actors as well on this one. And then some of the features, too, from the old releases as well. But like I said, really cool new releases. Both of them have really great pictures on them. And like I said, really great new artwork on these ones. Now, the next one, this is one I had not seen for a long time. This has an interesting story behind it, too, because the movie, like, the director actually based on a real thing that happened to him with this girl. So, like, and then when they made the movie, when it released in theaters, Lisa Silverstone's character had a different name. And then even on the old VHS releases, they had the original character name. But on like the DVDs and future releases, they had to redub the character's name because the family was threatening to sue. So it's interesting when you hear, because I was wondering about like some of the dubbing and like a couple parts when you said the name. And then when I read into it, I was like, oh, that's why it was like that. But the movie's called The Crush. Like I said, this is one I had not seen in a really long time. It's the first Lisa Silverstone's first movie before Clueless. Always loved her in Blast from the Past. That was one of my favorite movies of hers ever. ever. Like, I always really loved that movie. And this movie is basically, it's basically about this guy who ends up moving into, he's like this writer, you know, and he works for this company and ends up moving into this kind of guest house, in this really kind of fancy, richy kind of area. And Elisa Silverstone plays the daughter who lives in the house next, you know, that they're renting from. Cause like I said, it's a kind of like the guest kind of house that's connected to their house. Like, it's the house outside of it. And she's like this 14-year-old girl who kind of becomes obsessed with him and starts to really like him. And he's way older. He's like in his late 20s. And she kind of becomes infatuated with him, and she starts to kind of like be flirting with him, and you know, he kind of at first kind of just sees her as just a friend and stuff, but then she starts to kind of take it really far, and at one point she kisses him, and right after that happens, the whole thing kind of becomes a huge nightmare because she becomes totally obsessed with him. You know, he's seeing this other, you know, and then like the girlfriends that he has, she's coming around and kind of saying weird stuff to her, like, oh, he took me out to Lookout Point like this too, and we kissed, and she's like saying all this weird stuff, and you know, it just becomes this huge nightmare thing of total like obsession kind of fate or attraction kind of thing here. I said I really like this movie, and Lisa Silverstone actually had to be emancipated to do this movie because so she could shoot the long hours. So it has some interesting stories behind the whole movie as well. But it has on here though a new commentary track with the director, you know, writer and director, and interviews with Kurtwood Smith and Jennifer Rubin. You know, Jennifer Rubin is in this movie. I always loved her in Screamers. That's one I hope one point gets a Blu-ray release. But that's a great movie. She plays his girlfriend in this movie. But I don't know. This is a really good movie. There's some great scenes in this, too, where Lisa Silverstone's character comes to where he works. Like, that was like just, I don't know, just the whole thing, everything falls apart, and it's just like a total nightmare. I really love this one. This one I had never actually watched before, and this was kind of amazing. It's a movie called Roller Coaster. And you know me, I love movies and like things that take place in theme parks and all that kind of stuff. And this movie takes place in theme parks, and it's like all in theme parks. And that's what I really love about it. It's called Roller Coaster. It's basically about this crazy guy. His character doesn't even have a name. He's just sort of like the guy. And he's like, you know, basically he becomes like, he's like kind of like a terrorist kind of guy. He's trying to make this point, and he ends up in the beginning of the movie putting this bomb underneath of a roller coaster, and he ends up setting it off, and like it's like a great build-up of him. You know, you see like this thing there, and you're kind of wondering when it's going to explode, and like you kind of like just wondering what is going to happen here, and the scene is intense of when the roller coaster ends up going off. And but you basically find out this guy though ends up calling like this group of people saying that he's going to go and continue to, you know, wreak havoc in theme parks and places like that if he's not paid $1 million. And the one guy in this, George Segal is the guy who's kind of was in charge of like inspecting the roller coasters and stuff like that. They end up sending him in because the guy who's like the terrorist guy is kind of wants to have him kind of come along and deliver him the money. But there's all these intense scenes of at the theme parks and places like that they go to, you know, kind of wondering, you know, are they going to figure out if there's a bomb there? And kind of what's going on in that kind of stuff. It also takes place, too, in Magic Mountain, a lot of the movie. Like, the theme park scenes are amazing. The Magic Mountain, you know, they filmed Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park and a number of other things there. But it was just kind of cool. And it's like, to me, it's something really cool about this, too, because they even showed Paramount King's Dominion. You know, but back then, it was just, you know, King's Dominion. I don't even think it's called Paramount anymore. But I remember going there as a kid, and it was kind of cool seeing it in the 70s because they had, like, this safari kind of ride when you drive through this car. And it's, I don't know, I love things that are, like, real, like, sketches of time, like, freezing time and place of what it was and the look and everything. I don't know. I love this kind of thing. Has on here though an interview with the writer in the theatrical trailer, but highly recommend this one. Really, really cool, like suspense film of all that stuff going wrong with this guy and trying to figure out who he is and deal with his demands and all his phone calls and all this stuff. The next one, this is a remake of a movie called Kidnapped that I think it was Mario Bava, I'm pretty sure. Mario Bava's film. I don't know if I've ever seen the original one or not, but it's called Rabid Dogs, and it's basically about this, basically a bank robbery. In the beginning of the movie, there's these, you know, a bunch of these guys playing this elaborate bank robbery, and you see the one guy sitting in his car, and he's like the lookout guy who's going to drive him away. The police are there kind of saying, why are you sitting there? And he's like, oh, I'm just waiting here for these people to, you know, trying to take a picture, something like that. But of course, though, this robbery goes horribly wrong, and the one guy ends up killing these people there, and then they try and get away, and there's all these scenes of them driving through the streets and stuff, and they end up eventually taking this one woman hostage, and then they end up you know, their car gets screwed up. So then they end up getting in this car with his father and his daughter. And the daughter is very sick. She's getting ready to go to the hospital to have like a kidney transplant that they need to have done. So, but they end up basically, you know, hitching this ride with him against his will, like a gunpoint. And it's pretty much just about like them trying to kind of getting away. And then you're also kind of noticing like odd stuff. It's a movie too that has a lot of twists and stuff in there. And some really interesting twists. It's like one of those things that shows you like not to look at things, you know, it makes you like kind of like, it's supposed to be one of those kind of things that puts a point of not thinking things are always the way they seem and stuff like that. That's kind of like the concept, is not everything is always what you think going on and stuff like that. And that's kind of the concept of what this movie was. It has on here though a making of Rabid Dogs and an interviews with the cast, but a pretty cool one. I actually kind of like this one a lot. Like I said, I have not seen the original one, so I don't know how much it has to do with it, you know, compared to that, you know, the original one, and how many, you know, they changed it around or not. It was a French film, but it was a French-Canadian film, because I believe they filmed this in Quebec, I'm pretty sure. The next one from Sony, and this is one I was interested in seeing. I didn't get to see this one in theaters. This one is Sally Field's movie called Hello, My Name is Doris. And I've always been a fan of Sally Field, but I always think of her most from, you know, Mrs. Doubtfire. Like, it was one of my all-time favorite movies. This movie is Hello, My Name is Doris, and Sally Field plays this woman who works at this office building. She's worked there for years. She's kind of one of those people who's kind of behind the times, but they kind of can't fire her because she's been there so long. So they're kind of stuck with her being there. And in the beginning of the movie, her mother ends up dying. And when this happens, it kind of like changes everything about her life. And her family is trying to get her to move out of her house because they want to like kind of sell that house and her to move into a smaller place. And she's really stubborn about the whole thing. And she's also a hoarder. So she has like all kinds of stuff all in her house and like hoards up all kinds of old junk and old family stuff she can't get rid of. And like random like skis and all this kind of stuff. But she eventually meets this guy who, you know, comes to work where she works, and he's gonna be like kind of one of the head bosses, like the lower level bosses that works there. And she kind of becomes infatuated with him, and he's way younger than her. He's like 30 years younger, and she becomes totally obsessed. She goes to like this self-help kind of event where she's kind of told that anything she wants she can get as long as she tries. So she kind of becomes obsessed that she wants to kind of get with this guy. So she kind of is like trying really hard to get in with him, and she wants to hang out with him, go places to him, do kind of events and stuff like that, like raves and parties and stuff that she would never normally do with this guy, because she hopes that she kind of, that he will start to see her like that. And it's kind of like her, you know, really just trying really too hard to make it, you know, an impression on this guy and fit in with him and hope that she ends up getting with him. And it's kind of like you have to watch the movie to see if that ends up happening or working out or what ends up going on. But I actually like this. It's one of those really sweet, you know, well-made character pieces, and I really thought it was well done. And Sally Field did a really good job in this one. I like these kind of movies about like people trying to, you know, acting younger and all those kind of things. Has on here though deleted scenes, alternate opening, and a commentary track on this one. The next one is this new Sacha Baron Cohen movie. And I actually saw this in theaters and thought this is a pretty fun movie. And it's kind of like a spoof of like James Bond kind of action, kind of like MI6 kind of those, like a transporter, those kind of ones, but done in a really silly, over-the-top kind of vibe. And it also has a lot of heart behind it, too, and it's, you know, the Sacha Baron Cohen and Mark Strong and the Brothers Grimsby. This has on here, though, a bunch of different features on this, like extremely, you know, graphic out there, like deleted scenes and stuff like that. Because, like, you know, if you've seen the movie, there's one scene, it's a lot, I don't know, I don't want to ruin all that, but there's some really crazy, over-the-top sequences in this movie. But the movie's basically, though, about these two brothers in the beginning of the movie who are orphans in this orphanage, and the one ends up getting adopted and the other one doesn't. And it's kind of like they go to a different place and stuff like that. So Sacha Baron Cohen's always wondering where his brother is, and it's always been his like dream to try and find him, and he has like a bedroom set up in his house for him, and it's all, he's just basically always hoping that one day he's going to find his brother. And eventually the people in his town end up finding his brother, and he ends up going to him, going where he is. And the brother is an MI6 agent who's like on the tracking down these people and this whole bad stuff that's going on. And of course Sacha Baron Cohen goes there, hugs, like sees his brother and grabs him and hugs him. And the shot that the brother is getting ready to shoot this person to protect him and all this stuff going on, he ends up getting compromised, ends up shooting this kid, and all this stuff happens. Like people get shot, and then they end up basically going after the brother because they think, you know, Mark Strong's character, because they think he's gone rogue and gone crazy and trying to, you know, kill the one and all that kind of stuff. So then they end up basically coming after him, and it's a huge to-do, and he's basically stuck with his brother, Sacha Baron Cohen, and they're kind of trying to figure out the bad people that they were trying to get, on top of having to try and get away from the people who at MI6 who are trying to go after him. So it's a huge to-do. You know, Gabby Sidney is in this movie, has an insane scene in this, like an absolutely insane scene, and especially an insane scene with an elephant. There are some really crazy sequences in this movie, because if you know Borat, you know some of his other movies, you know that he really goes for it. This is not done like Borat, where it's, you know, on the street and that's like, that's an actual movie, though, but you know that he always goes for it and goes really over the top, and this is not the exception. It totally goes that way. Has him here, though, the making of Brothers Grimsby, Linorama, hilarious out. Takes deleted and extended scenes, blooper scenes, and then the elephant in the room, talking about the elephant scene in this movie. But I would definitely recommend this movie. I really thought it was a really fun movie. Who else was in this movie? You know, Rebel Wilson's in this movie as his girlfriend, as, you know, Sacha Baron Cohen's girlfriend in this movie. Some really funny sequences in this movie, but definitely check this one out. The next one from Broad Green Pictures, and this one, you know, this is Terrence Malick's new movie, and I wasn't sure what I was going to think of it, because I didn't absolutely love Tree of Life. But I actually really like this movie. And I was, like, really, like, interested in what was going on in this movie. And it's called Knight of Cups. And it has, you know, Cate Blanchett, Natalie Portman, Imogene Poots. Christian Bale is the lead in this movie. A couple other people in this movie as well. Teresa Palmer is in this movie. And it's basically about Christian Bale's character, who's this writer. And it's not, you know, if you know his movies, they're all done, most of, like, especially this one, improvised. There's no script. And it's kind of like the actors kind of come in, they do what they kind of want to do in the scene, and they kind of, like, kind of build. And it's all done, too. It's extremely filmed amazing. The cinematography is absolutely outstanding. It's a cinematographer who has done, you know, like Birdman, and he did The Revenant. Like, he's probably one of the top cinematographers in the world, I would say. With his shots, he is so good at, you know, just everything. The background shots and everything of the landscapes. Everything is so amazingly done with his cinematography. But this is basically about Christian Bale. And essentially the story, though, is he's this writer. And it's him kind of going through his life. You know, and I don't really tell you how long it takes place, but kind of in his encounters with the girls, the women that he's seeing, you know, like Imogene Poots, who's like this kind of punk kind of girl, and his relationship with her, and then his relationship with Teresa Palmer that takes him to Vegas, and then kind of their encounters. Also, the encounters with his brother. Who is his brother in this? I can't remember who his brother was, but I'm blanking on the name, but his brother, you know, and his encounters with his brother, and his encounters with his father, and it's like these weird sequences, too, where you don't know if some of it are dreams, because, like, the father's, like, washing his hands, like, with this blood in this weird, like, abandoned-looking place full of dust, and he goes to, like, weird Hollywood parties. I don't know, and there's a lot of cameos and people pop up in this movie, like Thomas Lennon and stuff. I really like this, and it has a good making of, a 15-minute making of, you know, just kind of talking about the process of making this. But definitely give this one a chance. This is definitely one of my favorite of Terrence Malick movies that I've watched. Because, like I said, I didn't love Tree of Life. This one definitely has a lot more to it, and a lot more of a deep kind of one of those movies where you really kind of think about your life a little bit when you watch this one. The next one from ViaVision, this is an Australian release. These ones, the next three are Australian releases, but these are all region free. It says on the back region B, but I checked these in the PS4, which is not region free, and they play fine, so these are all region free. And this is the David Cronenberg collection, which none of these have been released in the U.S. on Blu-ray, and it has on here Stephen King's The Dead Zone. It's a really cool Christopher Walken movie. Oh, and kind of him, he has like this telepathy power, like, thing, and kind of can foresee the future after he was in a coma. But it has on here, though, a commentary track and featurettes on that one, and Shivers, which is one I had never watched before. You know, Lynn Larony is in that one. It's basically about this high-rise building, kind of almost like a high-rise kind of building where everything is in there. They have, like, everything you could need in a building, kind of like the Clamp building in the Gremlins 2, kind of like that kind of a place where it was, like, a self-contained place of the future with everything you'd need in there. And this infection is kind of going on in this place, and it's kind of doing all these weird things to the people, and they're all, like, kind of spreading it around. It's kind of like this crazy stuff happening. Has on here, though, The Making of Shivers and an interview, and then Rabid, which is Marilyn Chambers did this movie, but I think it was one of her few non-adult films that she did. And she was actually really pretty good in that one. It was kind of her, after she was in this accident, getting reconstructive surgery, and then she kind of, like, what ends up happening to her, and she kind of, like, has a thirst for blood, and she's spreading this infection around. But it has on here a commentary track, interviews, and a documentary of the directors, David Cronenberg. But a cool set, like I said, if you're a fan of David Cronenberg, and ones that have not been released in the U.S., I'll put the link below for you. You can get these, and like I said, they are region-free. And this one, this is the movie I always remember as a kid. Like, I used to tape things off TV, and I always remember this is like one of the things that got taped off of TV, and I don't think I had ever watched it till now. It's a kind of an interesting movie. I don't absolutely love this one, though. It's called, with Demi Moore, called The Seventh Sign. Some movies without these kind of subjects, I don't always like that much, and it's kind of like, kind of like dealing with the apocalypse, and like there's even like in the middle of the desert, like it's kind of frozen over and like it's like snowy there, and it's kind of like the signs of the apocalypse are coming. And Demi Moore's character is basically, she's pregnant and she's with her husband, and this, they're basically renting out a room, and the guy who ends up coming into the house in the room they rent is basically like the second coming of Jesus and stuff like that. And weird stuff starts going on, and like she starts having these weird visions, and her character kind of has something to do with trying to, you know, prevent the end of the world. Like I said, it's kind of interesting, but not one that I would really say is one of my all-time favorites. This one, though, is a movie that always has really creeped me out. I only ever watched this once, and it was kind of cool to watch it again, but it always creeped me out. And I always think, when I think of this movie, I think of another movie which everyone forgot about. You know, Kevin Costner movie called Dragonfly, which came out around the same time, which I really love that movie too. Hopefully that gets a Blu-ray release sometime. That was a really kind of cool, underrated, and like some sad stuff in that movie too. Like, I'm not gonna lie, I love that Dragonfly movie. Like, but I totally, like, it's one of those movies, like I said, I don't think like anybody ever talks about it at all. This movie's a Richard Gere, Laura Linney movie called The Mothman Prophecies. And this is basically, though, about Richard Gere and his wife end up getting in this accident. When this happens, you know, she gets, you know, really messed up after the accident. She ends up dying. But before she dies, she's having these visions of this creature, this Mothman-type creature. And Richard Gere's character, after she dies, basically tries to look into all of this. And he's having all these weird things happen to him where he, like, time starts to escape him. And, like, hours can go by where he doesn't even know where he was. And he's kind of led to this weird town. And it's like there's all these creepy scenes of the bridge and stuff and him kind of investigating it. It's a very, very creepy movie. And it's really based on a true legend that still people talk about today. The next one's from Paramount. And these ones, I have both editions here, which is pretty cool, of 10 Cloverfield Lane. I'm going to show you both of them. This one is the general release one. And it has a cool slipcover because the slipcover, as you can see, it's kind of like, it's like split here like this, so it kind of comes out like this. I've never seen a slipcover like that, so it's kind of cool how it's like that and fits in like that. But basically, though, and then also this is the only Best Buy edition, the Steelbook edition. So this one you can only get at Best Buy, and this is a little look too at the back of this one, and a little look inside, and see here's a little look inside at this. But a pretty cool, you can kind of see the camera, I think, reflecting back there. But I really like this movie, and it's, you know, one of these things too I want to say too, it's important to note that you don't have to have seen Cloverfield to understand this movie at all, you know. And it's also one of these movies that and I'm not going to, I don't want to talk about the connection to Cloverfield, if there is or is not any connection, but I will say it does not matter if you've not seen Cloverfield. This movie can totally 100% stand alone on its own as its own entity of a film, you know. But the movies, though, basically, you know, John Goodman and Mary Elizabeth Winstead character, and basically, in the beginning of the movie, Mary Elizabeth Winstead's character gets in this car accident, ends up driving off the road, and then she ends up waking up kind of tied up in this kind of bunker underground. And John Goodman comes out and says, "Oh, it's all right. You were in a terrible accident, you know." And then, but he's being really sketchy and really peculiar, and he took her phone away, and she's like kind of trapped down there, doesn't know what's going on. And then he starts saying that, "Oh, you know," she's like, "When can I get out of here? When can I leave?" And he's like, "Oh, you can't leave. You're down here for, this is where you're going to be for the next, like, so many years, because there was something bad that happened above, and you're stuck down here, and I'm protecting you, and you're going to be safe down here with me." There's also another guy that he protected and brought down there as well. But it's kind of like, this nightmare of a situation with her stuck down there with John Goodman's character and the other guy, and they're kind of like figuring out what is going on here, and is what he's saying true? Is there really anything, that anything really happened down there, or is John Goodman just crazy and kind of kidnapped her and brought him down here, brought them both down there because he's just nuts? And it's like really weird, and he's got like, it's kind of like I said, Blast of the Past I talked about earlier. It's got that same kind of thing about, you know, the bunker and the doomsday prepper types with all the food down there and all this weird stuff, and he's got these weird magazines and stuff. I love this movie, but, you know, I don't love the end to it too much, but I'm not going to say what it is, but before the end of the movie, I'm not going to lie, there's some really truly amazing sequences in this movie. Like, it was, and John Goodman was scary in some of it, like when he was getting really angry and stuff when she wasn't listening to what he was saying, but definitely check this out, and it's a really good character piece too, and some really tense moments too of what's going on, and some stuff you're not going to expect, like crazy levels of stuff going on. I really like this a lot. Like I said though, I have both editions here, and then the Steelbook one though, this one you can only get at Best Buy. The next one, this is an interesting one from Paramount as well, called 45 Years with Charlotte Rampling and Tom Courtney. And this is basically about a couple who have been together for, you know, going on 45 years, and they've been very happy and things like that. But in the beginning of the movie, though, he gets this letter that, and he's like, oh, they found her. And she's like, what are you talking about? He's like, oh, they found her. After all these years, 50 years, they found her, and she's trapped in ice, and she was trapped in ice, and she's perfectly preserved as she was just the last time I saw her. And basically, it's, you know, what it is his old girlfriend that he was truly in love with, and, you know, he was going to marry, you know, who had this accident and was lost, and she ended up getting stuck in this ice, and no one knew where she was. They found her, and he becomes pretty much obsessed about this whole thing that they found her, and he wants to go and see her. And it kind of is putting a strain on the relationship, because Charlotte Rampling's character knew nothing about this, knew nothing about this other girl, and he's going, oh, I told you about it. I must have mentioned it to you once, and he never did. And it's this whole thing about him kind of questioning if he's even happy in his life with who, being with her, because his true love was this woman who, like I said, who they found her body. And it kind of just like put a strain on everything, and a strain on their plans and their 45th anniversary reunion, you know, anniversary they're having coming up, and their plans for that. I don't know. It was a pretty good character piece about just like about kind of rethinking everything in your life and stuff like that. I would definitely recommend checking this out. Like I said, it's a really good character piece. The next one from Fox, and I saw this one in theaters. This had a really limited release, and I thought this was actually really extremely creepy, and I really like this. It has Jeremy Sisto in this movie, and I've always been a fan of Jeremy Sisto since, you know, 6 Feet Under, and he was in Wrong Turn and a bunch of different movies. Always loved him and stuff. And this movie is called The Other Side of the Door, and it's an extremely creepy movie. And it's basically, though, this couple with their kids end up moving to the middle to India, because like they do curating, and like he sells like pieces and furniture and artwork and all that kind of stuff, and he's out there kind of acquiring things and selling stuff like that. And the mother is with her kids the one day, and they get in this horrible accident, and they drown, like the car goes down into the sea, you know, into the lake, and the son ends up dying. And after this happens, she basically becomes extremely depressed, and the one woman who works for them at their house, who helps clean up and takes care of the kids and stuff like that, she tells them about, there's a way you can see your son again one more time, and you can talk to your son. There's this place in the middle of nowhere you can go to, and she tells her all these things you have to do, and put his son's like ashes or body in the spot, and then when they go there, you know, you knock on the door, and then like the son will come back and can talk. But she's like, if you open that door up, you cannot under any circumstances open that door, because if you open up that door, something bad can get in. Of course, though, she opens the door when the son, because he's out at the door crying, when the son's soul comes back and starts talking to the mother, he's crying, so she opens up the door, and it starts a huge to-do, and lets in this horrible entity in the house, and is messing with the family, and causing all these horrible problems. But this, to me, was truly creepy. Like, I don't know, it's something about the concept of this movie, you know, really creeped me out. I don't know, I really like this, and there's not too many movies that are set in India either, and I thought that was kind of cool to set a horror movie in India. But definitely check this one out. I would highly recommend you guys check this out. I really like this a lot. Has on here, though, deleted scenes, and then some featurettes on this one, but really cool, creepy movie. The next one from Welgo USA is a cool kind of like sort of Langoliers kind of vibe movie a little bit. And like those kind of movies where like everybody goes missing and you're kind of figuring out where the hell did they go and what's going on. But it's about a group of these, you know, I think this was set in Korea, I'm pretty sure. And it's like basically a bunch of people who are on this bus, and they are, it kind of shows them all getting on the bus and things like that. And they all drive through this tunnel on this bus. And as soon as they go through this tunnel, they don't notice it at first, but like all of a sudden, right after that happens, it's like a snap and all the people have vanished. And they're kind of like, when they get out of the tunnel, they're noticing finally when they get to the town where they're all going to be getting off, because they're all getting off at different stops along the way, like at schools and the city and all that kind of stuff. When they get out there, though, they're like, where is everybody? There's nobody on the street. And they're all kind of like freaking out. And they're like, we don't really want to get out here. We don't want to deal with this. So then they eventually come up with the idea of giving each other's phone numbers to everybody and kind of splitting up and trying to investigate where everybody is, if they can find everybody, because they can't get anybody on the phone. They can't figure out internet. Nothing is working. It's like everything just sort of stopped at the time they went through that tunnel. And then like the people who go off, weird stuff starts to happen to them. It's like these sequences of them like turning into like stones, like their body breaks into stones. And you see this weird gas mask character kind of, you see it like split seconds of him around. And it's kind of like them all trying to figure out what in the world is going on, what has happened, if there's any way to get back and figure out how to like do it. So even some of them like running through the tunnel thinking they can get through the tunnel and fix it. And I don't know, I thought this was a pretty cool, like I said, Langoliers sort of kind of vibe movie. If you want to see a movie about people vanishing and trying to figure out exactly what has happened and where everybody has gone. Now this movie was really cool. This is a movie that I have to say, I feel like a movie is no one's going to see. And it's a shame, because it was really my kind of movie. And if you like The Sacrament, and you like movies about really creepy cults, and this movie is actually based on a true cult at a real place called like the Colonia Dignidad, and it was in Chile. And if you like those kind of movies about cults and that kind of stuff, definitely watch this movie. It stars Emma Watson, and it's basically about Emma Watson, who's this flight attendant who goes to Chile to see her boyfriend, who's kind of like this activist. I think he's from Germany, I'm pretty sure. And he's kind of there, kind of fighting because of the bad things that are going on in Chile with the people and their food and all this kind of stuff that's happening to them and the mistreatment and stuff. So he kind of is setting up signs and protesting about it and all this kind of stuff. And he ends up with her because he's taking pictures of them, kind of rounding up the people in his group. And because he's up there with Emma Watson's character and the people that are in his group, though, are getting arrested. And he basically is taking photos of them being arrested. And of course, doing that, they spot him, take his camera, and they end up sending him to, basically, they send people to this weird cult-like place where, you know, that's where they put like the prisoners in this. And it's kind of like a super religious kind of dressed down kind of place. Really weird. And it's like I said, this was a real place, and they're kind of like almost Red State-ish kind of feel too, but they're kind of sent in there. And Emma Watson's character figures out that that's where her boyfriend was set, so she ends up basically going to this place, knocking on the door, dressing down and saying she wants to join this cult and be there. And she's really only there to spy on it and try and find where her boyfriend is, and so they can get the hell out of there. And it's pretty much, though, she goes there, and the head of this place is this crazy guy, and he's really horrible when you read about what he did and stuff. And he's like lobotomizing people, and he's doing all these terrible stuff, and he's like really rough on the women and beating everybody up, and there's all this horrible stuff that's going on. But this is an absolute, like a really amazing movie. Like I said, I feel like no one's gonna see this movie, and it's like a shame because it was so good, and I really like this. Like, definitely check this out if you like movies about like stuff too, when you feel like after you watch it, you're like, man, you don't learn much in school, you know what I mean? Because all this kind of stuff that goes on in the past, you never learn about it. You have to see it in movies. And that's why I like movies, because you kind of come across and stuff you never knew about. And this is something I never knew about, and it was a really scary place, but a really well done movie about this, based on though a love story of her, Emma Watson's character, trying to find her boyfriend in there. But check this one out, really like this. The next one is another one that was pretty cool from Uncorked Films through E1, called Decay, and it says The Basement Holds a Secret. And I thought this was going to be like a necromantic movie, kind of, but it's not exactly that kind of a movie, but I actually like this a lot though. And it's basically about this like depressed guy who works at this amusement park with this guy, and he's basically just there. It's like a real desolate amusement park, and nobody's at it. And he's like, he says, oh, it's the off season, there's nobody here. And he's always there, like, cleaning gum off of things and cleaning things up. But when he goes home one day from work, he sees these two girls in his basement trying to steal stuff. The one girl ends up knocking her head and dying down there. She ends up slipping and falling and not, you know, basically dying down there. The other girl ends up running away into the street and getting hit by a car. So then the police, and you know, he tries to act like he wasn't there. So he just goes back inside his house, and the girl that's dead in the basement, he basically ends up keeping her body. It's basically him keeping her body on ice, and he's, you know, getting ice and, you know, keeping her in his bathtub. And he's this, also this guy is a total germaphobe, you know, crazy about germs. And they flash back to stuff with his family, you know, with his mother in the past when she was doing all these weird things. Like if he did anything, it was dirty and stuff like that. She's like, glue his hands to the wall in the house and all these like torturous stuff she was doing, putting his, you know, all this weird stuff going on. She was like really torturing him and, you know, giving him all kinds of problems. But she's basically, though, him doing his day-to-day routine, like on a loop of what he's doing, when it's like, you know, just collecting this girl's body there, and you watch throughout the movie, the body's rotting away and away and away, getting worse and worse and worse and worse. And like, I don't know, I thought this was a really creepy, weird movie. The guy was creepy too. Like, he played it really well as this really odd guy. You were trying to figure out what was going on here. There's some interesting twists and things that go on in this movie as well. I predicted what it was going to be, one of the things, but still, it was really pretty cool. Like I said, this one's called Decay. And the last one is a double pack, you know, with Christopher Lee and Klaus Kinski and Edgar Wallace's. And this has a double feature from Blue Underground of Circus of Fear and The Five Golden Daggers. The one I'm going to talk mainly about is Circus of Fear. These both, though, have really great transfers on these ones. Circus of Fear, though, kind of hard to explain, though. It's like about these guys that steal this money, and it ends up somehow getting, like, stashed at this carnival. And it's kind of hard to follow a little bit. But basically, though, you know, people at this carnival who are there are starting to get killed off, and it's by like a guy, and you don't know who it is. You see them like throwing knives and stuff like that, and you're trying to figure out exactly who it is, and the police are kind of trying to investigate the whole thing. It was a pretty interesting, weird one. Christopher Lee's in this movie, and the whole time he's wearing like this like weird like mask, like kind of like the guy who like cuts off people's heads in like the Victorian era and stuff like that. Like, and but he's like the guy who's like training the lions. But the way they did it like that, though, because there's no way they could have had him with the lions. So it was one of the ways to kind of double it so he could, you know, they could have the real lion tamer in the shots. It was an interesting thing they did, and it worked. It was like, because like Mr. Lee would have gotten eaten by the lions if they actually did it like that. But it was a pretty cool one, and, you know, Klaus Kinski's in this one. He's always creepy and odd and everything. I always love Klaus Kinski and stuff. He's very strange. But it's a cool release, like I said, of two, I would say, lesser known, you know, Christopher Lee and Klaus Kinski films. Like I said, two very good transfers on both of these ones. Anyway, though, guys, that's all for this update video. Thanks again for watching and subscribing, and I'll see you guys later.